This is Morning Express on this 30th day of May 2016. It's time for Sports Chat. And today I'm sitting in for Robin Toskin, who's not around. He should be back next Monday. And thank you for joining us. And this morning we'd like to first of all talk about Aspire Football Dreams. And joining me to do that is none other than the operations manager, Rosemary Wambui. Thank you for coming in for this. Now, maybe we can just start from what exactly is Aspire Football Dreams?
Aspire Football Dreams is a program that was started about 10 years ago in 2005, and its vision was to look for young players who could then have the opportunity to develop and get to play professional football at the end of it all.
Okay.
The focus was for especially players who don't get the opportunity to do so, to be able to advance them to a level where they actually can see that hope becoming a reality.
Okay. Well, when you talk about the opportunity to play, what is an opportunity to play? Is it just a field? Is it a ball?
Well, it starts with a field and a ball. But what we do is actually go to the grassroots. Right now, what we have is scouts and sports managers accompanying them going around Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, and Rwanda to the grassroots. They are up country, going to schools, going to fields, looking for boys who are out there, who love football, who have the talent, but may never get the opportunity to be scouted. So we actually have scouts who have come in from Spain and Senegal, who have gone out to look at this talent, be able to assess them, and then give them that opportunity to advance from that point on.
Okay. And what age groups are they normally looking at?
We look at the ages 13 and 14, strictly because we want to start them at an age where they are mature enough to handle, but they're also young enough to be able to be developed, to become professional,
to be groomed
to be those players. That age is taken as, because at the end, the lucky few do get scholarships, and by the time they finish, and it's an educational and sports scholarship, by the time they do finish, let us say it's like high school, then they can become professional players.
Okay. Yeah. And when you talk about the scholarship being educational and also on football, which takes more preeminence? For instance, I may be a very good footballer, and then do I get education, or am I a good scholar who maybe loves football?
The focus is on the football.
On the football.
On the football. The idea is to get, if you're a good scholar and you love football, the question is whether you're a good enough football player to actually then move on to be a professional football player. If that is the case, it still works for both. But of course, you spend a lot of time practicing. There's a lot of time and energy spent on practicing. They do get opportunities to play with other teams within their age group from various countries, from Spain, from Europe. So they do get into the international field to gauge the talent, so to speak, and get them used to the idea of this is what it's going to be like when we do get to that stage.
Okay, so Aspire Football Dreams is not a local outfit?
No, it's not a local outfit. It is. It started in Qatar and was the dream of, shall I say, grassroots coach who is from Spain and worked with FC Barcelona. They put together this program, and his focus was mostly on Africa and African players. So we have majority of the countries that scouts come to are in Africa, with two in Asia and three in Latin America. The focus was to get branches, people to run these programs. The local people are the ones running the program, but it is started and run by Qatar and the Aspire Academy in Qatar and Aspire Football Dreams, which is based in Senegal as well.
So what's the objective of once you've nurtured and identified the talent and fine, they've become professional players, is this then now to distribute them to different teams, or are they going to form a team themselves?
No, they do at the end of it all. Initially, they are the Aspire team, various teams, and that is to help them play those games with the international players, with other teams like them. But at the end, the idea is to then transfer them to international teams, and which we have done. Aspire Football Dreams actually owns a team in Belgium, KAS Eupen, which is just managed to get to Division One. So that is an example of giving them the stage. We are setting the stage for them. They're managing to cross over to an international team, get to learn from that level. We also have one player who is in FC Barcelona, actually, and another player who was
identified through
who went through the program. He's from Nigeria, Senegal, and Cameroon, actually. There were players who came from those three countries. They went to CAS UPenn, and then one went across from Cameroon to FC Barcelona. We also have one in who plays in Budapest. And also, the players who are identified, those who don't make it to the international field, doesn't mean that's the end of it. We have about 40 players who have played for the national team in their respective countries. We also have two players who have gone through the program in Kenya, one who plays for Tusker FC and the other one who plays for AFC Leopards.
Okay. Yeah. Now, this is all good, and it is a very good initiative to actually nurture, you know, identify and nurture that talent. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we have always said, especially with a sports fraternity, mm-hmm. is the fact that we have more of individuals who nurture the talent, and then when they shine, we own them as a country.
Yeah.
From your experience, what is it that the government could do so that we can also have our own program like this, which nurtures, because I think it would also reach further. I mean, how long are Aspire Football, the scouts who are here, how long are they here?
They're here for 2 weeks.
Okay, which is a very short time.
Which is a very short time, but let me put it into perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Within East Africa, within the four countries I've mentioned, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, and Rwanda, we have what we call 60 centers. Within those 60 centers, each center had an opportunity to look to get 704 boys initially, have them play games, win them out, and in the end, the scouts are actually coming to look at 176 boys per center. So if you
who have been
pre-selected by the local coaches in the grassroots, whether it's their PE teacher or you know the club coach in their respective areas, and this is mashinani kabza, so it's a big opportunity. When you look at the numbers, it's about 10,560 boys that the scouts are coming to look at within East Africa. So that's a huge pool as it is. That number is going to be narrowed down at the end of it all, by the end of this week, actually, be narrowed down to 50 boys from those countries. Those 50 boys will then come to Nairobi, and over a period of 3 days, have coaches and experts from Aspire Academy in Qatar come in and assess them and have them go through a series of games, test them physically, test their resilience, their technique, and also, you know, just take them through the course, teach them a few things in the process as well. And at the end, we get about 3 to 5 boys who are selected to go to Qatar at the end in January next year. January, because the scouts still have to go through the countries that are remaining.
Mm-hmm.
In January, all the boys from the selected countries come
January
together.
2017.
Yes.
Okay.
All the boys come together from the selected countries, about 30 boys, so to speak, thereabouts. And at the end, 18 to 20 boys are selected from Africa to get the scholarship.
Mm-hmm.
And they get the scholarship for the Aspire Academies in Senegal.
Okay, now once the scouts are here, what is the procedure for now identifying that these are, you know, who the people who qualify?
Love football?
Mm-hmm.
You play football.
You need to be good at football.
You need to be good at football.
Mm-hmm.
They look at intelligence, field intelligence. They look at stamina. They look at teamwork. How do you play together as a team? The scouts are going to already established teams.
Mm-hmm.
We work with people in the grassroots who are already working with their own local boys who have gotten the teams together, and whether they play for fun or whether they play to develop the boys, the idea is to give any boy who has the talent, the skill to progress, that opportunity to be able to actually see this dream of mine to become a professional player is a possibility.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, for a 13, 14-year-old, obviously, they're very much involved in school.
Yes.
And you've talked about also there being scholarships that would be given to them. What sort of education system would they be integrated into? Because should they not qualify to go into professional football, or maybe later in life if they decide, well, I'm not really interested in football, I'd rather pursue other things, what foundation for education do they have?
Okay, one thing we as Vision 21, the organization that actually works with Aspire Football or runs Aspire Football Dreams in Eastern Africa, look at a more holistic package. Not all the 10,000 boys get an opportunity, and not all the 50 boys get an opportunity. Mm-hmm. But we do speak to them about what else they need to look at. The 3 to 5 or the 18 boys who then qualify to go to Senegal do go through an education system. They go through high school. Mm-hmm. But the high school has the focus on football as much as education.
Right.
And they are encouraged, and we do encourage them even at this stage, at the grassroots, that education is still important. Football, yes, it's good, it will take your time, but yes, what happens when your body refuses at some point, right, or if you don't get the opportunity, that they should leave their options open as well. Mm-hmm. So we do like to take them through life skills, have them understand that professional football is an awesome dream to accomplish, but there's nothing wrong with the plan B as well.
And education, I guess, is also very important. I mean, even if you're a sportsman, education does need to
absolutely
be there.
And just because you love sports doesn't mean that education is shelved, because education, there's so much you can do. You can become a sports manager, you can become a physiotherapist, mm-hmm, you can work. The organizations that run sports are actually larger than the number of players themselves. Mm-hmm. So really, the education part can never be taken for granted.
For granted.
Yes.
Okay. And your thoughts on our education system regarding especially looking at sports, because we have an education system that really pushes academia,
yeah,
more than any other, you know, extracurricular activities. What are your thoughts on that?
My background is in an education system that actually looked at holistic. We used to play sports. We used to have the arts.
Was it homeschooling?
No, it wasn't homeschooling.
Okay.
But to develop any child, you need to build them holistically. Books are good. Education is excellent, but they're not made up of only that. You need to build them emotionally, spiritually, physically as well. And books don't teach a child to how to interact socially. Books don't teach a child how to work out there in the world. So sports help a lot to build character. They teach...
And even life skills.
And life skills, exactly. So the aspect of not paying attention to some of those is something we really need to relook at in our education system. We need to look back and see what is it that works so well that many of our leaders went through that system. It worked. Mm-hmm. Why not continue with the system? Mm-hmm. Bring back, yes, let's focus on education, but also let's focus on other things that build up a child. Mm-hmm. Too much reading sometimes burns out. They don't have any area to release their energy, to release their frustration if they don't succeed. And also, as you say, if they don't succeed in education, yeah, what are their options?
Absolutely. And maybe as we are getting closer to winding up this particular interview, there is the aspect also of so many children who would want that opportunity but are not going to get it. Is there anything Aspire Football Dreams is doing to, for those who don't qualify, because I'm sure there are very few who will qualify to go to Qatar and maybe their dreams, you know, be pursued on that end. What about those who are left but would still love to play football?
Vision 21 actually runs programs or works with like-minded organizations that work with young people who want to build their sports side. And we used to provide opportunities and programs where we would have young people, sort of like the Ligi Dogo system, but not just on football. We would focus on basketball and volleyball. We would have young people have the opportunity to develop that skill. We'd have professional coaches come in, sometimes guests from Spain, from the US, come in to teach them about what's happening out there. This is how we work it out there, because here we have the vision that out there it seems to work, here it doesn't. Mm. So it's to say, yes, we can still have the same technique, the same skills, work with the same skill set, and you can still have the opportunity to go out there. And there are many programs within Kenya that do that, but Vision 21 as well works with young people okay. to develop that.
Away from the school curriculum, do you feel like the government possibly does, and this is not just now on football, but in terms of sports, do you think it does enough to nurture? Because I think we really have a lot of talent that could go to put Kenya really on the map in terms of sports. Are we doing enough?
No, we are not. No, we are not. If we look at what happens out there, as an example, they have academies that are run by the local governments that actually work at developing young people in whatever sports arena they're interested in. So you have you'd find a club here in, let's say, in Kawangware, specifically geared to the young people around there, to just have them go out. They form clubs, they in whatever skill they're set there, they're interested in, and they develop it, and that's where things are developed. But these institutions are not run by individuals, they are helped by local governments to do that. And I saw this a lot in Spain, where in literally every town you'd find that kind of a club. Mm-hmm. And that's why you find the level of football in Europe is seemingly much higher, but it's because the government has paid an interest. They have
invested
in building areas where children can actually, clubs where children can actually go and play, whether for leisure or whether they're serious about it. And, you know, it's everything is being left to the individuals. If the government just gave that infrastructure, for example, then we would find myriad of coaches coming in and people who would actually even volunteer at some point to help these young people develop their talents. Mm-hmm. So if we just had that little push, I think we would go a long, long way.
Is there anything like organizations like yourselves doing to engage the government and see whether we can push that agenda? I know one of the promises that had been given by the Jubilee government is to have 5 stadia done, which of course has not been done. But is there anything to push for this to be realized, these dreams to be realized?
Unfortunately, the government who has a passion
what you're seeing. Mm-hmm.
For what we are seeing, what many people are seeing, that develop.
Passa on.